Welcome back, everyone. We have one more match today. But first, let's talk about Super Hot Crew's win in that last game versus Rockat. Super Hot Crew, of course, coming off a victory earlier here today, but it was Rockat that came out strong.
Yeah, the laning phase was really all about Rockat. They found more picks. They moved around the map more effectively. They actually built up a pretty hefty, sizable lead. They were, of course, playing against the Kassadin, so it was always going to take time for Selfie to scale up. I'd like to point out that that was a first pick Kassadin as well. Selfie, for me, is now picking more champions in multiple games than we'd seen in the spring split. Two different levels of success, but it's nice to see him coming out of his shell and experimenting on the stage.
That's exactly where I wanted to go in my point. The fact that Selfie is looking more comfortable, seems to be playing to a better level, bringing out new picks, forcing bans on the likes of his Yasuo there, which I think was a good idea from Rockat to actually do that in the end. Fact is that they still have a bit of work to do, but as Impaler said in the interview there, they're working on it. They're getting their plan together, and they're going to only get stronger, in my opinion.
Yeah, and to follow up on that point, we saw that they were very aggressive, both Impaler and Selfie. They really wanted to make plays happen, which I think is a very good sign coming into this season.
It is when it works, but it didn't always work. I think a little bit of over-aggression. I still think Impaler on Lisa needs some more time. His early game decision-making is not the greatest. When you play a Lee, you can get kills earlier on if you pick the right engages, and I don't think that he's doing that just yet. It was nice to hear in the interview he said, well, we knew the Elise was coming, so, you know, it's good that from a strategic standpoint they understand their enemies. And what was even better is that Super Hot Crew bided their time. They waited until Selfie had items, had levels. There was one horrible Baron call by Rockat very early on in the game. They committed, tried to sneak it, got caught, surrounded. Super Hot Crew got a bunch of kills. Selfie got three of them. And you should never, ever, ever give Kassadin any kills, let alone a triple.
Yeah, and I think it's part of the problem that a lot of these teams really seem to be having right now when it comes to mid-game. DeFizio said it right, that they kind of just went, what do we do? Okay, let's try and sneak a Baron. That's the only thing they knew.
Yeah, absolutely. And the second time, it came to bite them in the ass once again. We actually have a replay of that, because when you have a Kassadin that's so fed, he can just come in there and peel you off of it. Let's get that up on the screen right now.
Yeah, so the second Baron attempt, both teams are even. I mean, 4 towers to 3, 4 kills to 7. There's 500 gold separating these teams at 35 minutes. Rockat are not out of this game, but for the second time, they're trying a borderline desperation Baron play. So if you look at the minimap, you will see that Mimer is not in the fight yet. He will be teleporting shortly. Let's roll this clip out and just focus on how effectively Super Hot Crew pick their targets. Rockat are tightly grouped, but they just get shut down by a very, very good point-blank Darkbinding from Weevil Failer. His Soul Shackles forces Rockat into panic mode. So instead of them trying to focus the target down and pick fights, they're in scatter mode. They're running away. There's a fight on multiple fronts. Selfie runs down a target. We see Mr. Rolls untouched, completely untouched after getting 4 kills. That leads to the Baron, and that was the fight that just gave Super Hot Crew complete control of the game. Rockat were trying to rush and panic a Baron. I have no idea why, because it was clear the game wasn't about to end. It didn't feel like they were so far behind. Yes, Kassadin was getting scary, but European teams, and you stop panicking about ending the game and figure out how to do it properly and without or with less risk.
And using a pink ward in the right position so that they actually have vision. If you notice on that one, they did actually pink ward a little bit further in on that second Baron attempt. But as you said, it seems like let's just do it because there's nothing more immediate or better to do right now. I think teams need a lot of time on that and need to work on it.
Absolutely, but good on Super Hot Crew for pulling out that win. Our next match featured Fnatic, who had a jarring wake-up call at All-Star Paris against some of the best teams in the world. They realized that they need to level up their game and are hoping to put an analyst on the roster in order to give them a hand.
The All-Stars was kind of a wake-up call for all of us. We realized that we're kind of far behind of the Eastern teams. I thought I was really good. I thought I was really good, and I thought we were really good. And then I met these guys, and they kind of just crushed us. Their team strategies and micro strategy overall was just so much better than ours. It's more about how you use the map as a team, how you rotate, how you use the lanes, and how you use the waves. Because they were so good at like stacking up the waves, and at the point where these waves were about to hit your tower and you wanted to go down there to take all the waves, but they gave you no time to take this wave.
Everybody from SKT trying to work with this giant wave and this cannon minion to make use of it and go for another push!
Fnatic just too slow to the party!
Honestly, I think every team needs an analyst.
The problem is you need to have a good analyst and there is not tons of them in EU.
Getting someone who is really dedicated and is like actually good at the game can be tough.
It have to be like analysts which have the same knowledge as you as a player, or even better than you.
I think we have someone in mind and we might pick him.
I think Fnatic just beat Monte Cristo because he's the best.
Well, maybe he is Deficio.
Get Monte Cristo and you will win.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for our final match of the day. It is a biggie, ladies and gentlemen. Fnatic facing off against Alliance. Both of these teams drew level at 2-2 last split after the resurgence of Alliance towards the end of the season. Fnatic, however, pulled through once again to win the spring playoffs and represent Europe at the All-Star Invitational. However, Fnatic struggled in Paris, and yesterday things didn't go well for them either as they faced their age-old rivals, SK Gaming.
And Fnatic, they actually started out the game against SK Gaming pretty well. They pulled ahead in gold and were 5-0 early on. But then they simply just stopped making plays and just let SK Gaming control the pace of the game and also control the map. And this resulted in SK Gaming just picking up towers, objectives, while punishing Fnatic whenever they were out of position. And it's a bit weird again, because again, Fnatic's early game, it was fine. They played very aggressive, had good vision control, but they simply need to improve the mid-late game decision-making. During All-Stars, they had the same issues where teams would just punish them by playing the map. They just talked about it in the interview we just saw here. And I really hope Fnatic actually finds an analyst because individually, player-wise, they are so, so strong. They just need to get better rotations, get better decision-making, and get Monte Cristo.
We'll see whether that works out for them. Pretty sure CLG want to hold on to him for now. Alliance had a fairly decent first spring split themselves. It took them a while to get going, but once they did, they pulled out an impressive 8-game win streak to match that of Fnatic's back in 2013. Yesterday, they faced the Copenhagen Wolves, who pulled out a very different team composition, which they handled very well, honestly. But earlier today, well, they played the Supercell crew and lost.
So Alliance played very aggressive in the game against the Wolves yesterday. They invaded early on the blue buff and they kept taking it away from the Wolves throughout the entire game. Alliance, they fell slightly behind after the failed dive, but then they just managed to retake the lead with the Baron, with the failed dragon fight for Copenhagen Wolves. And from there on, they just used the siege comp to take full control of the map and this never gave the Wolves a chance to come back. But today, they looked very, very different. I mean, they lost the bottom lane to Super Hot Crew, where Draven, he got ahead of Lucian. And also Super Hot Crew got every single objective, like 4 dragons, they got the Baron, of course. And by the time Alliance could actually try and team fight, they were, one, too far behind. And also, Selfie and Yasuo just completely destroyed them in these fights. So they were completely outmatched. Today, or now, against Fnatic, they need at least to make sure they don't do the same mistake and completely lose the bottom lane to Draven and also didn't shut down the assassin in the mid lane.
Well, we'll see how it works out. For now, though, let's check out those starting lineups. Over on the blue side, it is Alliance, and that means it's going to be Wicked in the top lane, Shook in the jungle, Froggen in the mid lane, Tabs as AD carry, and Niff on support.
On the red side, we have Fnatic. Source is up in the top lane, Cyanide is the jungler, Xpekka in the mid lane, Reckless as the AD carry, and Yellowstar, of course, on support.
So we're just going to take a small moment to get this game underway, of course, as this game holds two of the most experienced mid lane players in the world. It would be foolish of us not to focus on them for our featured matchup. Of course, I am talking about Xpekka and Froggen.
Froggen, he's a player with many titles. I mean, he's the Spring Split MVP, he's the captain and creator of Alliance, and he also led Team Ice to victory at All-Star Paris. He's a player you can always rely on to do his job both inside in the game, but also out of the game. He has strong mechanics together with knowledge of every single mid lane matchup. Trust me, I've talked with him. He knows every matchup in the world. And also he has a very deep champion pool, which makes Froggen so, so hard to play against. And while Froggen, he has a lot of experience, Xpekka, he is the mid laner in the LCS with the most experience in pretty much the entire league, maybe. The season one world champion, he was one of the few Fnatic players to actually deliver at All-Star Paris, and while he was inconsistent in the last split, then we also know how good of a player he can actually be. He's on the level of Froggen, in my opinion, when he brings his A-game, and after Fnatic's loss yesterday, he needs to do it today and help carry the team.
Well, we'll see how this works out for them. Of course, you guys at home, Watching this one, you are able to take part. So which one of these mid laners do you think will come out on top? Head over to Twitter and send your choice to @LaLaWellaEsports with the hashtag Froggen or the hashtag Peke to let us know, and we'll see later on in the game.
And we also need to see how many papers Niff brought to the game this time. Because
do you think Wicked's got some more drawings of Aurelia?
Maybe.
He got to play him in the last game. Yeah. Maybe that's what it was. He's like, Aurelia, I pulled the Aurelia card out.
It was actually something Super Hot Crew said. We expected it. We knew he was going to pick Aurelia. We were fine playing Shyvana against it. Perfect for us. We didn't even have to focus any bans on the top lane. Could be something Fnatic wants to do as well.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Picks and bans about to get underway. We'll see how this final game of the day works out. Alliance up against Fnatic. First ban comes through. It is Elite, of course, taken away. You can see Niff with that piece of paper ready and waiting, giving Wicked the instructions. What he's going to take away there. Froggen just giving him some words of encouragement. We do see the Ziggs ban. Froggen not going to get to play that one. LeBlanc taken away from Peke as well.
So I like the ban so far from Alliance. Elise really is one of the go-to junglers from Sarnath. He always managed to find kills early game with it. And of course LeBlanc, expected played it yesterday. Did really well on it. Take it away, don't want to risk anything.
So that Cassidy taken away, we just saw it in the previous game, how it can turn the game on its head. Selfie finally managed to get himself going. Leona being banned away, that's a favorite of Yellow Star, so no surprises there. We'll see how these analysts have worked out for Alliance. Of course, a lot of investment. They did let Yasuo sneak through the cracks last time, so maybe the research wasn't quite up to par for that match.
Well, not exactly the hardest one to research. We've been banned in pretty much every single game against Super Hot Crew.
Apart from Alliances.
Yeah, I actually think they just wanted to leave it open because they thought they could counterpick it.
It can't be that good on it, surely. Yeah. Let it through.
They played Lulu against it. First picked it this time. He is a frog and he really wants to play Lulu. Don't expect it to be in the top lane for Wicked. Could of course still be support, but seems for now, or at least I would expect it to be for Froggen in the mid lane.
Lulu always looks so happy in that picture. Twitch banned out again, up to an 81.8% ban rate now. And Jax, of course, was left open. Will Soaz take that one away? We'll see if he will. He's got plenty of time to pick. And of course, conversation going on between Fnatic. A lot of pressure on Soaz, of course, after yesterday's Aurelia, and a lot of talk on Reddit about him, yes. But he's a man that's been around since Season 1, a veteran of League of Legends, honestly.
And always been a guy who could have a bad game, and then the next game all of a sudden he would just carry the team by himself, so a bit inconsistent, but at least a guy who continues to work hard towards the goal of course, becoming one of the best top laners.
Well, Lee Sin was locked in. That could be so as his champion in that top lane as well. It's something he's played a lot of. Lucian also locked in for Reckless.
And this Lee Sin pick here, if it goes to the jungle, it's pretty much for most teams now the most popular jungler. Feral Flare, it's been nerfed again. Nocturne, generally the Feral Flare junglers fell out of favor. Lee Sin there. Elise got nerfed. Kha'Zix got nerfed. Lee Sin just stayed there for now. Of course, there was a small nerf to his safeguard, but still, overall, as a champion, he is so, so strong. Was left untouched, damage-wise, at least, and that's why these teams really like to play this in. Also, because you can put so much early pressure on tower pushing and lane swaps.
Currently discussing what they're going to use. Will it be the fresh support stolen away? Don't want to let Yellow Star maybe through on that one. Niff has played some great games on it himself. Discussions. Pieces of paper have been thrown away. The bans, this is all they were used for. They didn't have anything else left and ready to go. Evelynn was locked in for Shook. No surprises there. They didn't need much research for that. It's the champion he played the most in the spring. And Thresh locked in for Niff.
So, very standard picks for both of them. Seen them so many times on these. And overall, Alliance, in the games they've played so far here in the Super Week, it's been very standard picks. Like, no surprises, no cheesy picks or anything. It's just been very standard all around. And we could even see Wicked lock in Shyvana here later on. He played it yesterday as well. Just to be even more standard for Alliance.
Well, Jax was hovered over for both teams. This time it is going to get locked in. So, Soaz in the top lane on Jax. And of course, well, Yellow Star going to fall back to the Morgana pick. We'll see whether Alliance lock in those two champions. But these ones, this is going to be Soaz on Jax this time around.
So, due to the fact they could lock in Jax, they can then take Morgana for their disengage. So while they have Jax pushing, split pushing up in the top lane, he's gonna beat pretty much every single thing Wicked could potentially lock in a 1v1 late game. So they keep Yellow Star in the mid lane on Morgana to just disengage and just let Source do all the work in the split push late game.
It's 100% win rate so far for Jax players. We'll see if it stays true. Or Soaz, quick lock-ins here. Kog'Maw was locked in for Tabs. We also saw Shyvana, of course, for Wicked, and the final lock-in, as you just may have caught a glimpse there, was Twisted Fate for Peke.
So with the Kog'Maw here from Taps, you have actually a very good comp from Alliance to protect him in the fights, and he can then deal out all the damage towards Fnatic, but he needs to be so, so careful. We have Twisted Fate who can port down on his face, Jax will jump in, we have Cyanide who can jump onto him as well, there's multiple members who can get to him, he's very mobile of course as the Kog'Maw, needs the help from Lulu, needs the help from Nif on Thresh here to stay alive. And Alliance basically, they want to go for these team fights where they can just kite back and have Kog'Maw do all the damage, and Wicked and Shu can stay in the front line, they can try and flank around him for the engage onto Fnatic, where Fnatic here, multiple options. Great wave clear of course with both Twisted Fate and Lucian, great split pushing with both Twisted Fate and Jax, and also disengage potential. Lucian is one of the best AD carries at surviving when someone engages onto you, and at the same time, Lee Sin can kick someone away. Very mobile. Morgana with the Black Shield with the Binding. So much disengage here and so much split push for Fnatic.
And of course, no cleanse for Kog'Maw. We can maybe see that QSS picked up early on by him. So let's check out the numbers to see how you voted for this match on LOL Esports. And of course, it looks like you've picked Fnatic by 61%. Not surprised there. I mean, Fnatic, huge fan base. Of course, we saw a 91% vote for Alliance earlier on today, but they didn't have a good showing against Super Crew.
Against SK Gaming yesterday, but that was just one game for Fnatic. Alliance. I mean, oh yeah, Alliance had a bad showing against Super Hot Crew. We'll have to revenge themselves here, of course. Fnatic, they lost yesterday. It's only one game. Still need to see what they can bring. We know how good of a team they are.
So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Final game of the day. We're in the Super Week start for the Summer European LCS. It is Alliance starting out as the blue team with their captain in the mid lane, Froggen, up against Fnatic. And of course, Peke leading the charge for them as the red team.
So Peke is starting the same way we saw Kassadin in the last game. Flask, potions, expecting to get poked a lot here by Lulu in the early stages. Just want to survive them, get some levels going. The more levels onto Twisted Fate, the more dangerous he becomes. And of course, once he can start putting some global pressure, if he goes up to the top lane, gets a kill, either for himself or with the Source, so he really gets ahead of Wicked on Shyvana here, then it's just going to be one thing for Fnatic the entire game, that is split push all day long.
No engagements coming across. You can see, of course, you guys at home been voting for this one. Hashtag Peke seems to be winning out so far. I'm to use them at LOL Esports. Hashtag Frog in the opposition. 55% currently for Fnatic and, of course, Peke to see if he wins out that rivalry in the mid.
So Yellowstar actually started with a sweeping lens here, simply just to remove the very first ward he spotted Alliance putting down. And now Fnatic, of course, Alliance didn't know they're in here, but don't actually have direct vision of them. So they need to be careful. They can't just walk in and pick it. Putting a very deep ward here, so they're trying to spot out if Alliance is lane swapping, because now, of course, they see Nif. They know he's in the bottom lane. He won't be able to get to the top lane. Or will he actually try and bait it out? Yeah, he did. Walked away. So maybe Fnatic now thinks he's going to recall and go to the top lane.
We'll see whether he does or not. Of course, pings all over the map, and it does mean that they are going to be starting off on that red buff. We're going to see Alliance doing the same. Tabs and Nif hoping to try and catch someone coming around that tri-bush there. They're actually waiting around the side, heading up towards that blue buff. They may actually go for a steal on the blue buff, you know.
They will actually go for the steal here. Need to be careful on the way out. They don't spot the remaining members of Fnatic, because if the bind lands onto one of them, they are going to be the target. And it's a lot of CC early on here, so we need to see. But very, very risky, but still very smart move by Alliance, taking away this blue buff.
Well, good plays from Nif, launches it away, and Tabs manages to get that blue buff. And that will be problematic, because Kog'Maw can make good use of that blue buff. Oh, stun in the mid lane for Froggen there. Peke mentioned to pull the gold card, but the Dark Binding was flashed away from, and that Glitz Lance will be enough to stop Yellowstar. But they can see, of course, it is going to be Yellowstar and Reckless moving to the top lane up against Wicked.
So yeah, four-man early gang on to Froggen here. Managed to escape it, of course, but still, Yellowstar had to go to the top lane. And now we see both Jax and Lee Sin can just farm away in the jungle as much as possible in this lane. So Pegado taking a lot of damage.
Flash used early, Ignite went down as well. Shook tried to get some of that damage down on towards him with the red buff to burn, but you can see Cyanide countered nicely when it took the blue buff of himself from the Alliance jungle.
And this is one of the things about the 4.7 patch, where the fast push in lane swaps stopped, or most of the game stopped.
Oh, Shook flash for it! Shook going in, he's got him! Shook with the first blood on Peke.
So the little lens landed from Froggen, and then Shook just flashed in for the kill here. Peke already used the flash before, couldn't get out here. Early first blood for Alliance.
Very good start for Alliance, just 3 minutes into this game. SOAS trying to protect, trying to cover off. He's still only level one.
And this goes back to the point with 4.7 and fast push is gone. So junglers now often go into the mid lane to gank when there is a lane swap because the dual lanes can handle it by themselves because they slow push it. Where, of course, early on, the jungler would always be in the lane swap to either push a tower or defend it. It's still something teams need to get used to.
Well, Wicked is, of course, covering off the top lane. Meanwhile, SOAS, he's having to run defensive duties in that mid, which is leaving the bottom lane to Alliance for free. And, of course, Tams with that blue buff key on hammering down on towards it. Shook, he's got himself first blood early on, so a chunk of gold in his pocket as well.
Alliance down here might not be able to get on the first wave, but then Source needs to be very fast at trying to defend, and he needs help. If he's alone, Alliance will be able to take the tower just in a few waves by itself. And Fnatic up in this top lane here can actually do the same against Wicked. He's been farming fairly well for a guy being in 1v2 and is ahead. Both CS almost ahead in levels. He's gonna hit level 4 before, at least. Oh, he actually already is level 3 and Source is only level 2, so he's also ahead in levels compared to Source.
Tams making sure he finishes off that turret, takes as many CS down as possible, and now they're gonna look to try and freeze that lane out and keep SOAS as far away from it as possible. Cyanide finally clearing out that blue buff at the 4.5 minute mark, so that's gonna be a long time before that's available for Peke.
This was absolute perfect timing by Tap with killing the tower. Every single minion died from the tower, reset the entire wave, so it means for SOAS, he's gonna get denied now from the CS because two members from Alliance are just gonna push him away, and the wave was just gonna be stuck in the middle. Peke though in this mid lane, he needs to be very careful because Sugar's nearby again.
Flickering on that card, does manage to get the gold one this time around. He's already thrown it out. Remember, there's no flash, all ghost available, and Peke, wow, run down, mowed out by Shock once again. Sugar
got the flash as well from Cyanide. He tried to flash Safeguard in to save him. Wasn't in range. Another kill now here in this mid lane, and Peke really been shutting down, or trying to shut him down here, and it's working for him.
Well, Wicked's been pretty much zoned out as well in this top lane, so Yellowstar and Reckless doing just as good a job. You can see SOAS feeling a little bit more confident. Still only level 3 though, and he's up against 2 level 4s, I tell a lie, because Niff hasn't yet to hit level 4, and look at that wave. Built up so huge, and he's just got to stay away from it.
Taps did it so smart after the tower dived, died, because he actually stayed with the minion wave, which came in from Fnatic side, and then he pulled aggro from it. So he got all the minions to group together, which meant the first minion from Alliance coming was going to be the target for all the minions of Fnatic, and therefore it started pushing towards Alliance, and they've just been zoning Swords away completely, while Wicked picking up some decent farm in this top lane.
It's interesting to see Europe finally picking up on all of these intricate little plays,
yes,
with
this
minions.
This is something in Korea they've done for such a long time. SKT did it at All Stars as well, where you deny the entire wave, and then afterwards you make sure it pushed towards you, and you just deny the top laner forever.
Yeah, and it's something, of course, Reckless was talking about in the feature just before this match, and you know, obviously it's something that everybody has been looking at since then, really wondering why, which surprises me it's taken so long for them to look at it, because, well, Korea have frankly been doing it for a year already.
It's a very good point. I don't actually have the answer for it. I'm just happy at least to see Alliance picking up on it now, and it really pays off, because Source, he's completely shut down. I mean, he's level 3, he has 6 CS at this point, only a Dawn's Blade and his boots. He's actually going now towards the mid lane even, trying to at least do something, because this bottom lane, he's not going anywhere.
Speaking of doing something, Peke's having problems, of course. He's now got Ghost back available, but Froggen's been having a bit of free time in this mid lane because Shooker's, of course, coming twice to get the kill. You can see SOAS waiting off the side. They want to try and make a play. They want to make a play onto Froggen, but Lulu is so hard to pin down. He has the shield, has the speed buff, can use it for a picks, whatever he likes. And, of course, Wild Growth to top it all off to give himself that boost of health.
And also Shook being nearby in case something happens, can join in, help out here. This tower, though, should go down on the next wave. Of course, Wicked, he knows he's going to die, but he's just going to pick up all the farm he can in meanwhile, and also the experience. I mean, he's 3 levels ahead.
And look at the bottom lane. Look,
it's
where
not going
it's
anywhere.
It is going nowhere. Tams has got that lane completely in his pocket. It's 32-8. SOAS just being starved out of this game, frankly. And honestly, it's nothing to do with him. He's not had a chance in this game so far.
And we need to see now with Alliance here. Now the wave is actually pushing towards Fnatic. They're going to build up a big wave, push it all the way up to the tower. We need to see if Alliance want to rotate over with either the jungler or with Froggen, and make sure they can prevent Source from picking up the wave. If they can dive him under the tower when this massive wave hits and force him away, he's gonna get completely denied everything and is out of the game.
Well, look at that bottom lane. Niff was just staying around in the tri-bush, keeping them zoned out. SOAS is just He's just chilling in the bush right now up in the inner turret. Wicked though, he's in trouble. Yellowstar coming around. Can he land the Dark Binding? Pounces away already. Dark Binding flashed away from. Wicked gets away safe.
And look here, look who's moving towards the bottom lane. Sugar's going there. They want to deny the entire wave away from Source. He's only level 4. I mean, there's nothing he can do against 3 members.
Yeah, you can see 2 level 6s and a level 5. They're going to move in towards this inner turret. They've got maybe Peke that could come across with the Destiny to help out, but he's got his hands full with Froggen, and so has doing all he can, honestly. He's trying to get the experience from the other side of the trees.
Beautiful, beautiful play by Alliance. Really playing the map, playing the waves so well here, denying everything from the Jax. The late game power spike now for Jax is going to be delayed so, so much, and this means simply Wicked can now be the split pushing.
This is something Alliance have picked up over the summer.
Yes.
There's no doubt about that, because they...
This is what Europe needs. This is what Europe has been so terrible at doing. Punishing properly from the lane swaps. And Alliance now, first time we see a European team do this, and they do it perfectly, and it works.
Yeah, Fnatic attempted it against SK Gaming. It didn't quite work out. They managed to actually backfire a little bit more, to the point that Fnatic were ready for it. SK were ready for it, but again, Alliance taking everything away from that bottom lane, full power in their control, and of course taking that dragon has given them a 3,000 gold lead. Honestly, has put them in complete control of this game. Finally though, Soaz, he got himself that bottom wave cleared out, but you can see the difference between level 7 to level 5 for Wicked.
There's only about 1,000 gold on Source, so it's not like he can go back to base and buy one or two items like his Phage or Sheen. No, he's gonna go back, get one item, and his teleport is already gone, so he's going to need to run all the way back to the lane because he had to teleport there to get the farm. So Alliance has been doing a great job trying to shut him down.
And the fact is, he's now in a 1v1, but he's 1,000 gold down on Wicked. 2 levels down on Wicked. That's a big problem for Soaz. He's going to just basically have to sit on that tower.
And Alliance can just go up and dive him again. They can do the exact same thing. Move multiple members to the top end. They're actually doing it now. Tap's joining in. Niff is going to join in as well. Fnatic needs to send multiple members to try and defend. And even if they do get in a fight, Source is going to be weaker.
They do have support coming, Cyanide off the side, but Niff getting that ward down in the right time will spot out Yellowstar as well. Soaz gonna be screaming his team, I need some form of help here, something to help me get back into this game, because Peke had his own problems early on, so he's not been able to use Destiny to get around the map, to back up maybe Soaz, to give him some support, because Shook did such a great start there, getting the two ganks on him.
Yeah, of course, all the pressure in the mid lane meant that nobody could help Source. Cyanide couldn't run down to him as soon as the tower died so they could then push out the wave. He couldn't do it because he had to stay around the mid lane to help because there were so many ganks going on there, and Xpekka died twice for it already.
Destiny being pulled out. Where's he gonna go? Nowhere, simply being used for vision. Froggen may have to flash out of this one. He will. You can see he's gonna get out safe, or will he? That's gonna be the gold card used there. The wild card will not land. Shook still lingering off in the distance. What I was about to talk about is the pure amount of vision that Alliance currently have in their inventories.
Also because they are pretty far ahead already from 11 minutes, and now Shook coming in here. Only 2 members from Alliance, but they're still going for it.
They're going straight in, the wild growth pops up Peke, but he gets bounced around. There's 4 members collapsing in towards him, they finally lock him down. Reckless comes in. Now Froggen's gonna be the target, that proc will come off, the smoke goes down, it's a double kill for Reckless.
So a bit too aggressive from Alliance here, Fnatic. Reckless was already moving towards the mid lane, instantly responds, picks up 2 kills, can also take the mid tower here, at least get a lot of damage onto it, just what Fnatic needed. Niff will be here to defend it, so it can only push down the wave, go back and heal, won't actually get any damage.
Sadly, while this is all happening, of course, while they've got them kills, it's giving Wicked free farm in that bottom lane. Niff comes up into clear out that minion wave, but he's now 71 CS to 27 of Soaz. He's been continually locked down by a level 8 Tabs, but Tabs has to start being careful here. Despite the fact Soaz hasn't got much damage items, he still could put a little bit of outlay damage onto a Cogmore.
Would be very risky though for Soaz to actually jump him. You don't know if Nip would be nearby. Yeah. Also, Tabs being so far ahead with the Cutlass will actually kite him around. Soaz though, didn't recall yet, waiting for his teleport to be ready. One more wave, and then he can actually go back to base.
So finally, Soaz gets some farm, gets himself 2 or 3 waves this time around. Alliance, how are they going to react to this one? The 2 deaths in that mid lane set them back a little bit. Good ward coverage is what's required, and Shook immediately getting that ward swept out by Yellowstar, putting himself a ward on top of the pink ward. They know that it's there, but they can't risk it this time around. Maybe they're going to try and make a play. Peke is well aware, and of course has nice flash available to him this time to escape Shook's grasp.
Despite all the action in the mid lane, Peke dying twice early on, he's actually ahead in farm of Froggen here, so he's been farming very well. Also with Cyanide, of course, staying around the middle lane for backup in case something else would happen here and feel more confident. It's what they need. Yes, you're down two. You died twice already, but as long as you continue farming, Twisted Fate will get to his late game point where he can really start both split pushing, destroying towers, and also his damage is going to skyrocket once he gets Lich Bane, Death Cap, Void Staff. All these kind of items.
The real big difference for Alliance is simply Wicked. We'll see how he makes it count because you can see Fnatic setting up to make a play here. They have pinged out, they're pretty sure, and there you go. Destiny being used, they kind of thought the nip was there. Froggen has to quickly throw out that Lantern. Will ride it away. Sonic Wave did not land from Cyanide. Instead, a Glitter Lance will. Niv may get caught out here. Instead, he's going to throw the Death Sentence out. Sidestep by Peke. Shun comes in around the side. Gold Card pulled, though. Quickly puts some damage back down on towards him. Teleport comes in. Wicked joining the fight. Peke trying to get away from this one. He's going to be so ass joining in as well. He has to cancel it out because Tabs has already picked up the kill on Yellowstar.
Very, very fast reaction from Alliance here. Spotted the fight. Teleport came in. And Peke, he went very aggressive towards Niv. So he got a bit out of position. The team was far away. Engaged onto him, got a lot of damage, and then Yellowstar was the guy they left behind to die. The Lions responding well. Soas takes a lot of damage here from Taps.
Dangerous play here, actually. Soas doesn't fancy it. He's going to jump away. He has got himself the Bilgewater Cutlass, but again, it's a, as I mentioned, it's a pretty high damage. Taps himself got the Blade of the Rune King already complete as well. So Soas not wanting any engagement just yet.
And we need to see what Wicked decides to build in this game here. He is so far ahead, if you went for Blade of the Ruined King, got in the lane with Source, he would destroy him one-on-one, completely destroy him. Yesterday he went for full tank Shyvana. We need to see if he will do the same, or if he actually will try and put some focus on using the lead he got now and just pressure Source away every time there's a one-on-one.
So third turret of the game down for Alliance, still zero for Fnatic, and now they're making a move towards Shook here and then towards this Dragon Pit. Where's he going to go? He gets caught out. Nicely done by Cyanide. Gold Card will get pulled. Shook's in all sorts of trouble. He's going to go down. And now with the Dragon spawning in 5 seconds, this is good timing by Fnatic.
Yeah, great timing. Didn't even have the Destiny from Xpekka here, so wasn't actually even a gank coming in. Just Shook being out of position. Cyanide land the Sonic Wave and they could engage him. Pick up the Dragon now as well for Fnatic. Alliance staying nearby. There's only two members, won't even be able to get it. No Smite, of course.
Death Sentence flung out, not really going to catch anything. Now Tabs is in trouble. Soas is feeling a bit more confident, but again, forces the flash out of Tabs. Nicely done this time around. Soas starting to get himself back in this game.
Really starting to do some work here with the Cutlass, of course, building towards Blade Rune King. Once he completes it, once he gets some more livers in his free farm, he will still become this late game monster. It is just delayed by a great start from Alliance, but still, he's going to hit the point later on.
So 4-0 in turrets, one dragon apiece for Alliance and Fnatic. Wicked continuing that farm. Double the CS off Soas so far after having the advantage early on, but Soas, he's not done yet. He's starting to cleave his way back into this game, taking down these minions with ease, as Jax will tend to do. Peke, he's starting to get some freedom as well now, and that may be danger times for Alliance.
And they shouldn't have Kog'Maw being in the one-on-one against the Jax. They should have the Shyvana, who's so far ahead, to just punish him again and again. Jax would never, at this point, be able to kill Shyvana. We saw before here when he jumped on the Taps, he was forced to flash away. Didn't want to get stunned, didn't want to risk anything. So it's the wrong matchup, at least, he chose. But they just want to also just get farm onto Taps. I mean, they just want him farming away, because he's going to be the late-game teamfight carry for them. The rest of the team is built around protecting him. He's going to be the one doing all the damage.
Well, at the moment, his protection's going to have to come from Niv. He's trying to get up there because he can see members of Fnatic all moving towards Tabs, who is in this top lane, keeping that wave pushed away from him. Three members of Fnatic closing on him. Niv in there to cover it off, and you can see Alliance moving in numbers to protect.
Let's see here. Wicked is pushing down the bottom lane. Still a long time before he hits the tower because they already killed two of them in this bottom lane. Reckless should be able to just pick up all this farm for himself fairly easily. He's back in the mid lane. Again, he's actually farming really well. Died twice early, got the Lich Bane here already. Got his Magic Paint boots. Just looking for a chance. Shook still staying around his mid lane all the time. He want to look for something.
Alacrity being picked up by Tekken and his Sorcerer's boots along with that Lich Bane early on. We'll see how he progresses in his build, of course, and that Flash goes. It's kind of the standard for Twisted Fate these days. Ooh, Shook is actually looking to go in towards that mid lane. At the moment, we can see this top lane. It is building between both of these teams. Everyone looking for ganks. Oh, look at that. Wicked coming around the side there on Peke. Does get a little poke towards him. We did see Shook. He was looking to go for it. Alliance want to make a play here. The red buff may be the one they're going for.
Could be a big fight here with of course, the box from Thresh, but also with the ultimate from Morgana, both supports can provide a lot of CC in these small jungle areas. Just taking the red buff though, backing away. A little bit surprised also by Xpekka, he didn't go for distortion on his boots, so he got less cooldown on his ghost, his flash, and of course also got the extra speed up when he used both of them. Decided though to go for a lacquer tree, so just a straight up 20 movement speed for him.
So pings on the top tower there, that's telling me tonight. Insisting they really want to finish this one off. Look at the top lane there. You can see they're trying to set up a gank on towards Soaz. Nip comes in. Does manage to get the flay on towards him. Soaz, though, good jump away. Will game scot-free. Peke now having to use the ghost to get away as well. So Alliance trying to make the plays all across the map, but so far Fnatic starting to avoid the danger.
Yeah, and they're picking up much needed farm. Every single time a gank fails on Soaz in the top lane or they leave him alone for just 30 seconds, he will get some farm, and we see him working towards Wicked, still far, far behind, of course, but picked up a lot of farm for a guy who was so far behind early on. So it's working out for Fnatic now, just defending. Alliance have the map control. They're the ones starting fights, but Fnatic are just holding on and making sure they can farm towards the late game.
Yeah, despite that 4-0 advantage, they have tried to take away as much as the jungle from Fnatic, and it seems to be working. We'll see how that affects Cyanide, actually, as the game progresses. Shook, of course, is behind in CS at the moment, but did, of course, get, importantly, those two kills, kill assists earlier on in the kill. Tabs himself, well, you can see, looks like it's going to be the Trinity Force being built up next for him. We saw a Cogmore earlier on. Wolite played it yesterday to, honestly, great success. He didn't get the win, but it was a good performance.
Very good performance. There's a lot of damage in team fights. Of course, again, your positioning as an AD carry needs to be perfect. If you don't have any jumps, there's no way for you to get out. If you get caught in a bad position, you are going to die. So Taps, luckily, is one of the AD carries with great position here in Europe, and therefore also they can build a combo around him and give him all this farm. That's why they're investing so much farm into him. Just keep putting him up in this lane here. Take more farm, we need you to get to the late game point. We need you to get Trinity Force, which is a very good item on Kog'Maw because it makes your mobility and ability to just straight up kite in a team fight a lot better. Also, of course, the extra HP from the Phage is gonna help when he's gonna be the target. So he can kite around a little bit every time he hits, of course, with the gets the speed up with the movement speed, and then he can kite around. And also actually the Sheen gives him some decent up straight up damage.
Well, the Fissio was dropping some knowledge. You saw a lot of pings going on there, of course. It will see. 5-man attempt from Fnatic seemingly in the top lane. You can see Peke getting close towards it. That was against Tabs and Niff, and wisely stepped well out of the lane. They have given freedom to Wicked once again to push that top lane, and you can see a lot of Fnatic grouping for this one. Blue buff is the invade. The Alliance are going for a Fnatic. They want to fight.
They want to fight. Rek'Sai coming in, still a bit far away. They need some engage. Either a bind needs to land here from Yellowstar, or Source has to be the guy going in together with Cyanide to start everything. Xpekka doesn't have his Hourglass yet, so he can't be the guy to jump in the middle of everything. But Wicked pushing up the top lane, Source though teleporting there to stop it and picking up all the farm.
Oh, with that teleport now down, I wonder if we're going to see Wicked maybe making a move down. You can see three members of Fnatic, they're pushing for the middle turret while this blue buff's taken. They may get this one. They're going to step away though because they know the danger. They see Wicked off the side who's made his way down, didn't need to teleport, just simply ran down here. He's caught Yellowstar off on his own at the moment. Yellowstar in trouble, has to use that ultimate, pounces away. Wicked will get stunned out, but he's already taken very low. The rest of his team join him. And why is it Yellowstar backs away? That may buy time. Dragon is now up, and with that ultimate down, it's an important fight for Alliance.
And also with the teleport down from Source, it's going to be a free Dragon here for Alliance. And now is the time where they really need to use the advantage. Wicked needs to go back to the top lane, go one-on-one against Source. He has to teleport. The rest of Alliance need to just group up and start pushing. Wicked can join in for a fight with his teleport and just be 5v4 while Source is stuck in the top lane all by himself. We also see Wicked building towards the Bladed Rune King. Would actually like to see it being the first item, maybe just gone Giant's Belt or a Fallen or Chain Vest and then into Bladed Rune King so he could use the advantage early on over Source. Now Source with his own Bladed Rune King should be able to at least somewhat fight back.
I'm not sure on that one. Wicked, it's something he actually used to do. He used to go for those aggressive items early on.
And this
on.
Time he actually should.
And often back down.
I know. So maybe he's feeling insecure. He wants to be have some tankiness first, but
not sure insecure is the word, but well, maybe he's been told. Maybe he's been told this is the way to.
No, I know for a fact Wicked decides his own builds.
Yeah, there's no way someone's going to
trust
tell him.
Me. I've talked with the rest of Alliance. They do not always agree with the builds.
Well, we'll see how it works out for them. So far, he has a 50 CS advantage. The rest of Alliance, they're motoring around. They had the red buff stolen last time around, and it looks like that Froggen and Nif may well try and do the same. Soaz is actually caught off the side here. A good death sentence is not going to land from Nif. Froggen trying to get some poke towards him. That top inner turret is pretty low, and Alliance are here in numbers.
Pushing every single member up here, so not going to use the teleport advantage they have. Instead, they actually just want to straight up push a fight. And Wicked, I'm going to try and buy some time for the team. Just see where the rest of Fnatic is. He's very tanky, of course. He's very far ahead on farm compared to Soaz, so he's very, very strong in case the fight should break out.
Good little lance from Froggen there, catching both on Soaz and Peke, poking them down their hit points. They're still trying to make a pick here. They're still trying to make a play. Red buff up, and the Alliance, again, going in bulk for it. There is the red buff. It's going to get pulled towards them. I've never seen so many people fight for it. Shook smites it away.
Oh, nice.
Death Sentence lands on towards Peke. Everybody pounces towards it. And now Fnatic are in all sorts of trouble. Wild Goat bouncing them around. Soaz does get a good counter strike down, but he's going to get locked up along with Peke. And it's Tabs that picks up the kills. And they are just motoring the way. Three kills against one for Alliance.
Beautiful max range hook here from Nif, starting the whole fight. And Peke actually flashed into his team. And Nif followed him there, put up the box. Wild Goat and everything. Look at his replay. Here's the hook. Peke doesn't expect to land it to land on him. He should have flashed away from it there. Then he actually flashed into the team, get the box, you get beautiful ultimate from Shook. Wild Goat, everyone is knocked up, everyone is standing together from Fnatic. They die instantly. Soaz managed to pick up one kill, but from here it's too late. And now with, of course, a Kog'Maw, you can take down Baron very fast.
What's the best way to protect a Kog'Maw? Everybody stand on his head. That's what it worked out there. So Baron buff picked up by Alliance. Big turning point in the fight here. Alliance, they've already got a good advantage. Cyanide's going to find Wicked, but I'm not sure he wants that fight. He's landed this Sonic Wave. He's going to try and buy some time here because Soaz was coming around the back, so he's just going to force him away for now.
So with the Baron buff now, we actually see Alliance already starting positioning in the mid lane. There's a big wave coming from Wicked. He already went back to base, got his Blade of the Rune King. He's very, very strong in his one-on-one. He just pressure it up, and rest of Alliance could just push up to the mid lane, force Fnatic into a bad situation. And if Fnatic moves out for a fight, well, Alliance are stronger. They have the Baron buff. They also got superior poke now, at least, again, with the Baron buff, with the regen they got from it. They can just siege up towards this tower.
It's a 4-1 split. Soaz off at the side, actually. Is he going to go aggressive on Wicked? Wicked's happy to fight him.
He's 2 levels
behind. Counter-Strike lands on towards him. Soaz thought about it for a moment and thought, actually, I'm not making too much of a dent on him. The rest of Alliance trying to get some force down. Cyanide hooked in. They're not going to follow through on it this time. Did manage to get a play on him, but you see Alliance had stepped too far away from the fight.
But still, Alliance staying in this mid lane here. They know they can just poke away, heal it up, back up. And Wicked getting a lot of damage on Soaz.
Dragon Descent being used. Soaz again trying to put the Counter-Strike down. Still yet to use that Blade of the Rune King on him. The rest of Alliance motoring back around there. That tower should fall. You can see there it goes. Nif taking a big burst of damage here. But Cyanide's got a little deep on that one. They still didn't get the kill despite the calling going out towards him. Shook having to be punted away from this one. Kog'Maw, can he land the hit? No, Cyanide has to flash away.
Still also got 50% damage on this mid tower here. Wicked already killed the top tower, so Alliance taking full control of these lanes here, getting a lot of damage everywhere, and we also just saw a fight here. Yes, Nif got cut out of position, but Alliance could just turn around because they are stronger.
Now that Trinity Force is complete, that Living Artillery is coming out from Taps, it's starting to cause a few problems for them. That's going to be another turret falling. 6-1 for Alliance. Fnatic only picked up the one so far in this game, and Alliance are looking very, very strong. All from that very early play. Great maneuvering with the minions, and honestly, they haven't looked back since then.
And then, of course, the hook from Nif.
Yeah.
Fight up their way. They get four kills, or three kills, I believe. Got the Baron as well. It was such a beautiful hook coming in, and then everyone from Fnatic was just standing together. So Wild Grove, ultimate from Shook, of course, landed on every single member except for Soaz, and therefore Alliance could just steamroll over the team fight.
40 seconds on that Dragon. Fnatic waiting, Alliance waiting around, and they didn't really have the timer down because it was Fnatic that took it last time. They are going to keep on pushing, though, this bottom wave. Blue buff stolen away by Fnatic. Small victory for them. They're trying to make a trap, but
now realize
Alliance are not really interested. They're just piling up that bottom lane. Fnatic, they have to recall quick.
They can get so much damage on this tower here. Alliance, need just go in and hit it, man. Hit it a few times, back away once you see Fnatic.
Gonna pile in there. They're gonna get a lot of damage down. It's half the hit point shredded off it already. Peke finally responds, throws out those wild cards, but again, it is only Soaz off at the side. There is no teleport available for Wicked, so that could be an inner turret picked up by Fnatic if he can keep pushing.
Well, the Alliance needs to go in and at least force a fight here, force the teleport from Source, otherwise he's going to get so much damage on the tower here. They are pushing, they're going for it!
Wicked goes in, Wildgrowth bounces Yellowstar in the air, Sinai tries to react to it, has to safeguard away to the side. You can see Wicked taking a lot of damage from the tower. Good hook on towards it, Soaz takes him down. Shook goes down in response though, it is a 1-for-1 so far.
So they went for the dive simply to force out a teleport from Source here. You actually saw them start the fight and then try and back out instantly because they just
another hook. Yellowstar caught out this time. He cannot survive it. Wicked's going to go down to the tower. He should get caught out. Yes, he will. Reckless picks up that one. It's a 1-for-1. The inhibitor turret now down. Destiny comes out, but I don't think they're going to follow through.
Not going to follow through. Sinai needs to land his Sonic Wave here. Everyone backs away, but Niff. Hooks after hooks, man. Picking up so many kills, so many crucial team fights for Alliance. He's playing so, so well.
So 4-0-1 so far for Tabs on Cogmore. Maybe trying to pick up that first victory for Cog here in the summer. Froggen, meanwhile, second game on Lulu. 1-1-7 this time around. It's not a champion we're used to seeing him playing, honestly,
nope.
Lulu. He's normally in I guess technically it's still a farm heavy champion, but normally a bit more aggressive.
Normally pick something where he's the guy doing the main damage in the late game. With Lulu, of course, yes, your late game damage is good, but you don't do the same as, let's say, a Kayle or Orianna or something in the late game. So he's more reliant now on, of course, the rest of the members doing all the damage, and especially Taps on his Cogmore, who is doing absolutely fantastic as well.
Well, so as he's continuing to try and get that farm going, Trinity 4 still yet to be completed, waiting to see if he's going to bait anyone in with this big minion wave. He's already pounced across, he's going to jump across back to Cyanide, giving him a bit of a buddy leap there. But the rest of Alliance, again, not interested. They are working their way straight up the mid lane.
And what they can do now is pretty much the same they did before. Four members in the mid lane, Wicked split pushing on one of the side lanes, get all the way up to the towers, and then Wicked, because this tower in the bottom lane is so low, just need a few hits on it. If Source is the one defending, he won't be able to hold him. They need someone like either Reckless or Xpecket to hold the lane. Otherwise, they're going to lose the tower, and now it seems like Alliance actually just want to go straight over there. Don't even care about the minions.
Yeah, they're going to straight in tank it. Soaz hasn't got teleport, so he's going to have to simply back to base, but he's going to be too late. The tower's already down. The inhibitor may follow. The rest of Fnatic down there in numbers. But Alliance will step away, as you mentioned. Not too worried about the turret damage this time when it's that low on health.
Also, of course, with Wicked being very, very tanky, with the shield from Lulu and everything, just to tank up all the damage. Running onto Wicked here, not tagged on. Nice hook!
Another great hook on Soaz from Niff. He's going to lock him down. Nothing he can do about that one. He's only built damage so far, no tank to follow. And again, Taps, with that range on Cogmore, it's the big advantage it gives you. You can hit that inhibitor from range and nothing from Fnatic can do.
This bottom lane for Alliance are clearly the MVPs of this game. Fantastic hooks from Niff, and of course Taps playing so, so well on Cogmore as well. Really making sure Alliance are in the lead of this game and should be the ones winning it, because again, they have such a strong team comp here, and they're just pressing up on the next lane. Fnatic, they need to start a team fight as soon as Source spawns.
Start something going, because Alliance are happy to just keep on pushing through all the damage on towards this inhibitor turret. Fnatic trying to respond, but that's a hit up the hit points ripped off it already. Wicked's going to be the focus target, but he's not really the one they want. It is that squishy little Tabs on Cogmore. Instead, he stepped away. It is going to be Alliance backing off for now.
Backing off for now. Baron, of course, is up. Dragon, still some minutes before he respawns, so won't be the target for Alliance here. Need to be careful, Pega really wants to ultimate in to start a fight.
Destiny gets pulled out, and instantly Alliance group up, five man. You've got no targets to pick off, and that's what Fnatic wanted, but there's no one available. Teleport is back up for Soaz, he's going to keep that split push going now. Got the Trinity Force complete, so we'll see what he can do with it in the next fight. Got to avoid those hooks from Niff, though.
And they've been spot on. I mean, every single time a fight has started, it's been Niff landing the hook, and then the rest of Alliance just following up on it. Popping the Wild Growth as well whenever Fnatic were close, so knocked them off and really chaining all the CC they had. Didn't get to stop him.
Well, he landed the card, he's just going to follow through to the fountain. So Wicked backs off, gets himself another Randian's Omen this time around. So he is even stronger, even tankier. And Rakdis is going to have problems putting some damage on towards him until that last Whisper is complete.
So if they get his Trinity Force now though, so he got his two key damage items, and he's now going to start to do a lot of damage, especially in a one-on-one here against Wicked. Still, is behind in levels, and Wicked also a whole item ahead of him. Tempo here is stronger on swords. Wise enough, picks up the farm, backs away, don't want to deal with Wicked for now.
Despite all the small glimpses of freedom that Sauaz has had, he's still 50 CS behind Wicked from the very beginning of the game, where, of course, that big advantage on Sauaz. So, Alliance not letting up their lead at the moment. They've done made good use of this lead they built up over time. Sure, maybe going in towards this one. Dart Binding only landing on Wicked, so they're not too worried about that one. And again, of course, it's the top or middle they can try and focus on. I guess they want to get Wicked split off. There is a big wave at the top half, but I think may well be the Baron they are focusing on right now.
Well, they need to get the side lanes pushing at least and go up to the top lane, start making a slow push towards Fnatic and then start setting up these traps around the Baron here. So if Fnatic moves in to start a fight, then the top wave will be pushing, and if Fnatic lose the fight, they're not only going to lose the Baron, they can just quickly go top as well, take the inhibitor. Teams Fnatic, they're just starting it straight up. Fnatic is nearby, and they're already pinging it. There's a ward from Cyanide. Teleport is also ready from Source. He can join in at any time.
He's going to pick his moments here. Frogger motoring around there, trying to look towards getting on towards Yellowstar. Taken though already, they do keep the Baron active. It's down to half hit point. Cyanide, he's got a great steal on this one before, remember, back at All-Star Paris. Let's see whether he can do it again. They are all aware of this one. The hook does not land. Instead, the rest of the team come around towards him. Cyanide, so low, forced to back away from this one. Teleport is still not coming out from Soez. He's still pushing the bottom lane. Baron does get picked up. They're going to instead counter it and take down the inner turret in the bottom lane.
Fnatic just wanted to try and go for the steal, so the rest of the members were not in a position to stop it. The Source, of course, didn't even bother to go up there, just wanted to take the towers.
Uh-oh!
Yellowstar, you're out of position.
Yellowstar caught out there. The Glitter Lance is enough to slow him down. You can see they're trying to pull the Destiny card out. That's going to be Wicked teleported in. Yellowstar nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. Shook catches him down, takes the Lantern. They're pushing straight up the mid.
This could be the inhibitor for Alliance. Only four members defending from Fnatic. Baron buff as well onto Alliance. Taps is joining in just outside the picture. It will take this one, take the inhibitor as well.
Cyanide's got to be careful, he gets hooked out. Nip once again on point with the death sentence. And it is Cyanide this time around that will go down. A bittersweet pill for sure. And it will be the inhibitor in the mid lane going down this time.
The bottom inhibitor is open as well. Alliance can take this one, rotate it down, get another one. They're going aggressive though.
Pyke may get caught out. Wild Growth, Randian's Omen. Zhonya's Hourglass is going to put him in a dancing stance, but simply he will go down. Soaz tries to pounce away. He is going to be enough with the Counter-Strike to save
him. Oh, stays alive.
About living artillery. He didn't get fired off. It doesn't matter. Alliance is going to keep pushing through the mid.
They could go for the finish here. They're getting both the towers. They will go for the finish.
Nexus turrets going down. They're going to be Alliance that will take down Fnatic here on the last game of the day. And Fnatic, they could be 0-2. Soaz jumps in. Last ditch effort again gets hooked out by Nip there. Tabs goes godlike at 7-0-2. The Nexus will fall. And Alliance are victorious against Fnatic.
Beautiful early game tactic to shut down the Jax and then the hooks from Nip to setting up fights left and right here. So Alliance, they pulled ahead, got the first Baron and just took full control of the map here. Full credit though, Taps and Nip played absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it was all about freezing that lane early on. Absolutely nothing Soaz could do about that one, simply put. Really well played by that partnership you can see on your screen there. Nip and Taps really led from the start. 7-0-2 on Cogmore, and you know, they just completely froze Soaz out. It left Wicked. He, in fairness, he was in a 2v1 situation for a long time, but he held on to that tower. Didn't really have a great deal of help from Shook, because Shook was busy in the mid lane with Froggen and Peke getting the two kills on Peke. Peke was helpless to do anything then, and it all literally led from that very early start for Alliance.
And just the fact Shook stayed in the mid lane to apply pressure meant Cyanide had to stay there as well to defend, so he couldn't join in with Soaz in the bottom lane once the tower died to push out the wave and reset everything, so the next time the wave got up here, Soaz could get some farm. But Cyanide was forced to stay in the mid lane, he couldn't help Soaz, and it simply meant they could freeze the lane forever. Taps got so much farm on it, Soaz got absolutely no farm. And then Wicked got so far ahead as well. Once he completed the Blitz Rune King, went up in a 1-on-1 and just destroyed Soaz.
But I think it's fair to say that's probably the most impressive play we've seen in Europe in terms of wave control early on.
Yeah.
Didn't really carry on throughout the game, in
fairness. Well, I think, I'm not sure, it seemed the Alliance wanted to play it more safe. Again, if Wicked had went for straight up Blade of the Rune King, first item, he would have been so much stronger than Soaz, he could have went straight in a 1v1 against him and just pushed the lane down. The rest of the members from Alliance could then stay in the mid lane and just push up again. Fnatic would never be able to engage onto them because they were behind. Because again, Kog'Maw had a great start. Lulu for the disengage. There's so many options for Alliance then to just disengage if something happened. And also, Fnatic would be forced to send two members top to defend against Wicked because he would be so much stronger. He was like four levels ahead of Source at some point. Like, he would destroy him in this lane. Could have done it if they wanted to go for more for an earlier victory in this one. I mean, wanted to go for more early pressure, but they played it safe. Wicked went for some tankiness first, then he went into Blade Rune King, then they swapped him into the top lane, and then it was pretty much came down to Niff actually landing hooks to start fights, and that's where Alliance really pulled ahead again.
Yeah, they never really looked in danger in that, that's for sure. So fantastic play from Alliance. Fnatic, where do they go from here? Because that was simply down to early level control, took them out of it, and they didn't have an answer. And they're really, it would have been very hard to have that answer, but it's something they've come up against before. Obviously, when they were All-Stars, they've seen Korean teams, Chinese teams, even American teams, Cloud9 doing similar,
yeah,
and making good use of the waves. And how are they going to counter this? How do they get into it? Of course, they've talked about trying to pick up Monte Cristo analysts. What do they do? Where do they go from here?
Well, I think if they'd been more used to the situation they got in, they had a set to expect in the mid lane, you're on your own. Sunlight has to go bot lane now and push it out. And therefore, they could have tried to stop the freeze from happening. They didn't, and therefore it just went the way it did, and Source got so far behind. But it just shows overall again, Fnatic is not on the same level as the international teams, but not even as some of the European teams at the moment when it comes to map movements and rotations,
which,
in general.
Which is strange, because if you look back at the playoffs, the semifinals, quarterfinals, it was all about Fnatic making the rotations. Mm-hmm. Alliance had no answer for it. So this time around, they've turned the tables. Maybe a little bit of practice has worked in their favor. For now, though, we're going to send things over to Shox and Quickshot, who have Alliance's Tabs standing by.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Turn the tables and how. 7-0-2 for you on Kog'Maw. I want to focus first on the mindset coming into this game and kind of what you altered because you suffered a loss from the Super Hot Crew earlier today.
Yeah, our loss against Super Hot Crew was mainly caused by one big misplay around the dragon and caused us to lose all the control of the game. So it was really easy for them to clear out the game from there, and we just had to clear our head, go into the game with a fresh mind, and we did.
What was particularly impressive to me was the way you guys played the minion waves and just denied everything from Jax. Was that the main objective coming into the early game?
Yeah, when the enemy has Jax, you really just want to try and deny as much as possible. And in the current meta, it's really good to just let all the creeps die on the tower so you can freeze afterwards. It denies a lot of CS.
It definitely did. Soez had 8 CS by 8.5 minutes before he finally got his got a few CS under a couple of waves. What I want to know is, what happened afterwards? It felt like once you hit the mid game, you slowed down a little bit, and Soez got a closer into the game. How did that mid game go for you? Was it still positive or negative?
The slowdown was caused by a bit of a misplay on our part, because we didn't call that Lucian was going to mid, so we engaged on mid, and then Lucian cleaned up 2 kills. That lost us a lot of tempo in our game, and it took us quite a while to build it back up.
Well, but as you go later in the game, you are a Kog'Maw, of course. That is great for you. Explain to us a little bit more of the finer points of playing Kog'Maw. It's the second time we've seen him here in the...
Yeah, Kog'Maw is really good in the current meta, especially after Riot reduced the W mana cost to 0. Makes his laning a lot stronger. And it's just really easy to get the late game with him now.
Yeah, good guy Riot taking away that mana cost. I want to ask about what the meta is for AD carry champions, because we've seen a fair diversity. We've seen Vayne, we've seen Caitlyn, we've seen obviously Lucian, Kog'Maw's up there. No Jinx this week yet. What's your take on the pool? Is there more viable AD carries? And, you know, what do you think?
I think since All-Stars, playing against the Asian teams just proved that Twitch is better than everyone else. So that's how we see, like, Twitch is banned every single game. And when Twitch is not in the pool, you have, like, Graves, Kog, and Lucian that are really good. I don't think the other ones are that great at the moment.
I've got a follow-up question about the comment about playing against Korean teams at All-Star. What is it about their play style that makes them so much better at managing the minion waves or the rotations that we keep talking about all the time from your point of view?
I think it's just their discipline. Their players are very trained to just keep a cool head and analyze everything perfectly. So they never really mess up.
And someone who didn't mess up at all either in this game is Niff. A little love for your support, because my word, those hooks.
Yeah, he hit some great hooks. Allowed us to end the game really early.
Yeah, absolutely. Great play from you guys all around. Congratulations once again.
Thank you very much.
And now we're going to head back over to Demon and the Fisho to take a look at the standings.
All right, thank you very much, both of you. So with that match complete, let's take a look at the table with 2 days of the Summer Split now behind us. Up first, well, it is a four-way tie in first place. Alliance, Air Millennium, SK Gaming, and Super Hot Crew are now all tied at 2-1.
Then we have Gambit with one win and one loss, and then tied for six, we have Copenhagen Wolves and Rocket, both have one win and lost two games. Fnatic, down in the bottom, a bit surprising, lost both their games.
0-2 opening games, and of course our first Super Week of the Summer Split continues on Thursday with five more consecutive matches. We start the day with Gambit taking on Alliance, and then that will be followed by Fnatic, who will be taking on the Copenhagen Wolves.
And then Millennium and Gambit will face off, followed by Rocket versus Fnatic, and then we'll close out the day and the Super Week with Super Hot Crew taking on SK Gaming.
And of course, those matches will begin on Thursday at 5 p.m. Central European Summertime, which is 8 a.m. Pacific. So for myself, the Fisho Show, Quickshot Shocks, and the entire LCS broadcast team, thank you very much for joining us. We'll see you Thursday.
He's gonna get his GA prop first of all.
Eventually!
What? Why did that take so long for him there in the end? There he comes back up again.
He's alive!
Last second intervention!
After, oh, everywhere.
Oh, no.
Go flash!
Okay, back up.
Yazoo!
Hot comes through, they managed to catch Froggen. This is going to be the fight. Ulti's coming in. Froggen's going to go down. Wicked's the next target in this one, surely. He's trying to run away from things and tanking up quite long here. We won't fail himself has fallen low. Shug will be the next focus. And surely now, like dominoes, Alliance are going to fall.
I'm going to get you, I swear.
Bam can't say such words.
Shook smites it away.
Oh, nice.
Dead Centers lands on towards Peke. Everybody pounces towards it. And now Fnatic are in all sorts of trouble. Wildgo bouncing them around. So Soaz does get a good counter strike down, but he's going to get locked up along with Peke.
Go.
Fight them.
Back.
I'm getting an energy.
Counter.
Are you on camera?
Two Korean pose.
Tries to go for it straight away. The attack damage pulls the shockwave back in there. Rift walk away from Sophie. The ignite down, he's got him. Overpower will get first blood here.
Yep.
Mimer's got a little too deep on this one. Overpower's going to be the focus target though. Sophie with the Zhonya's. Overpower with the Zhonya's. He's not going to get back out of that one. It's a double picked up by Impaler on his Lee Sin.